and the cooperation of everyone, I reiterate that call today. I wish to now give an update on issues raised in the petition as follows. So I will talk to them as they were presented, but I would classify them together, starting first with the legal aspect. I want to start by saying in regard to that the government reiterates the seriousness of sex and gender-based violence as we see it. The current legal and policy environment shall therefore be strengthened in order to strengthen our response in dealing with the matters related thereto. Specifically, there was a request to establish a sexual offenders register. That issue, we all know, is subject of a motion that is on the floor of Parliament, but I would like to indicate that there is already some work that has commenced in government, specifically in the form of research on the establishment of the register, even before the motion was brought to the House. The ongoing work in this regard includes considering the modalities for implementation of the register within the context of the law that requires, of course, us to comply also with other aspects of the Constitution especially. This process will be pursued with increased expediency. Currently, the register is provided for under the Domestic Violence Act in respect of sex offenders in cases involving victims below the age of 18 years, but not beyond that. So the work that is ongoing is to cater for victims beyond the age of 18 as well, and to strengthen whatever aspects would need to be strengthened in respect to victims that are younger than the age of 18. Then there was also a request for the establishment of sexual and gender-based violence offences courts. On this, I would like to indicate that the establishment of such courts has been agreed upon. Existing court infrastructures, the physical infrastructures, will be used in this regard, and where space is a constraint within the sector, arrangements will be made to use other available infrastructures within the public sector, but the courts would be established. The other request was to review the sentencing laws for sex offenders. Indeed, the seriousness of sexual and gender-based violence justifies that punishment reflects that. The current law provides for sentences for convicted offenders of up to 37 and a half years, which is equal to two-thirds of a life sentence. A convicted person must serve at least 25 years of such a sentence before being eligible for parole. We in the executive shall continue to work to ensure capacity building for efficient and effective investigations to support effective holding to account of perpetrators of these crimes by the court. There was a request for expedition of current murder and sexual offences cases. Measures are ongoing in this regard, and they include to compile a database of all active cases on the court rolls, undertake a joint investigation into why investigations are not finalized in pending cases, prioritize cases according to age of victims, age of case, and complexity of investigations, a contact to victims, family of victims in each pending case to update them on the status of the case, and the provision of psychosocial support to victims and witnesses to prepare them for trial. There was a request to review current prisoners in the correctional service system and separate known repeat offenders from other prisoners. Here, I would like to indicate that this is already being implemented. Offenders who are serving sentences of 18 months and longer, of which these offenders are a part of, are kept at different 8 correctional facilities where they are kept according to a classification which considers factors such as current offense, offense history, sentence length, and age at offending. This classification allows the prison authorities to discharge relevant correctional and rehabilitation programs to offenders in accordance with their classification. There was a request to revoke the bail of current trial awaiting persons who are accused of sex offences or murder. And the response is the courts can and do indeed revoke bail on application brought before it and supported by evidence. So the court are the ones that grant bail, and they are the ones that can and do revoke the bail. Also, the Criminal Procedures Act gives presiding officers at the court the discretion to refuse bail in the public interest. So it is not guaranteed that just because somebody applied for bail, they will be given. If it is considered that giving them bail would compromise the investigations or would give them an opportunity to repeat the same crime, they can indeed be denied bail. Now, on crime prevention aspect, there was a request to institute 24/7 armed patrols, 24 hours, 7 days a week patrols by the security forces. And I would like to indicate that the operations of the Namibian police are conducted, which include patrols on 24/7 basis. And special operations are also instituted. Currently, the operation Namib Desert is in operation, which comprise of the joint operations of the Namibia Defense Force, the Namibian Police, and the Namibian Correctional Service. Government will continue to mobilize additional financial and logistical resources to enable these law enforcement agencies to conduct more operations and patrols as part of crime prevention, including sexual and gender-based violence across our country. There was another request to disallow the withdrawal of sexual and gender-based violence cases. The response is that the current law is indeed geared towards ensuring that all filed cases of SGBV are taken to final conclusion. And it goes an extra mile to mitigate against withdrawals of such cases by requiring strict procedures before this is allowed. Unfortunately, however, there are instances where, in spite of these efforts, lodged cases are withdrawn by victims who filed them. While the state has the authority to continue to pursue such cases even when withdrawn by the victims, and does indeed make strenuous efforts to do so, the conclusion of such cases becomes difficult as cases rely on witnesses for conclusion. So if witnesses are not willing to give evidence, it becomes an uphill battle for government to secure a conviction in that regard. Prosecution therefore needs cooperation from victims and witnesses to give evidence in order for us to ensure that there is accountability for the commission of these heinous crimes. The victims are offered counseling and education in such cases, including sensitization for them not to withdraw cases. Communities are also encouraged to support victims and not to exert pressure on them to withdraw cases, because we know that this does happen sometimes. And there are other programs also that are being implemented. We know, for example, that the issue of poverty, you know, the abused person depending on the abuser for financial and economic support also does affect how they behave. And therefore, empowerment of women is also a priority issue for government, as we know that it also affects their vulnerability in situations of crime. The other request was to strengthen the capacity of GBV protection units. And here I would like to indicate that government will ensure capacity in these units. The Namibian police will identify candidates to fill vacancies at the GBV protection units, which number at 159 at this point, as a matter of urgency. And it will train also the GBV investigators. There was a request to capacitate forensic investigators and experts. Here, I would like to indicate that the recruitment and training of personnel in the areas of biological trace identification is prioritized starting this financial year. It was also requested that we should mandate the 24/7 operation of the GBV protection unit. I would like to indicate that these units in the Namibian police are components of the NAMPOL operations, which operates on 24/7 basis, 24 hours, 7 days a week basis. Although the GBV unit operates from 8 to 5, Monday to Friday only, there are provisions made for personnel to be on standby to attend to emergency GBV cases after such hours, during weekends and on public holidays. And this arrangement will be strengthened. The provision of remote and mobile GBV protection units was also requested. And I would like to indicate that these units at police stations level are integrated in mainstream police activities. But such integration does not negate on the seriousness of NAMPOL to deal with such cases. And special SGBV expertise are provided to each case. The patrols will also deal with such cases. So the teams that would go on patrol would also be capacitated to be able to provide assistance where there are these cases experienced. In the area of education, there was a request for curriculum development and implementation of SGBV prevention program. And I would like to indicate that the sector does have a program for educators and learners with appropriate skills, knowledge, and attitudes. So indeed, there is a program responding to this need as expressed. The following immediate actions will be taken or are being undertaken by the ministry, the relevant ministry in this regard. They include drawing up a curricula reinforcing safe schools framework, developing a communication strategy, a weekly messaging, and advocacy to strengthen all existing measures and programs, releasing summative report on the reinforced response strategies, hosting a multimedia news press conference and knowledge fair to showcase all strategies, and to continue and diversify capacity building of regional schools counselors and race coordinators, RACE coordinators. The other request was to liaise with CSOs and SGBV experts to coordinate with stakeholders outside of government, that is. And I would like to indicate that there are existing training plans on the matter. We shall continue with efforts to mobilize more resources to implement this training plan. There was a request to review all school rules to promote the fight against SGBV. And I want to indicate that the sector has a school self-evaluation against the national standards and performance indicators, and it undertakes necessary reviews in order to monitor the compliance of schools with this mechanism. There was a request to release any teacher in employment with sexual relationship with learners. And I want to indicate that a policy in this regard is already in place in the public sector, and it is being implemented. Those expelled on this offense are barred from re-entering the teaching profession in government for at least 8 years. Then I like to indicate that institutions of higher learning also adopted similar measures to curb such unethical conduct as part of the code of conduct. And as already indicated above, such institutions have the code of conduct to deal with disciplinary issues in general that are being operationalized. So I have indicated in the beginning that besides the work that was done to respond or to indicate how the government is going to deal with the concerns as expressed through the petition, we are still implementing the programs that we have adopted, so we are not being reactive. We are simply just going to ensure that if there is a need for us to do something additional to what we had initially planned in order to respond to the concerns as expressed, we are going to do that as indicated in this statement. But this is not a deviation from the plans that we have in place or an indication that this would be all that we will be doing. In concluding, as I indicated in the press statement that I released over the weekend, we in government, in the executive, do share in the repugnation of the Namibian public at the situation of sexual and gender-based violence in our country. And we are in full agreement with the public that this situation cannot be allowed to continue. We assure the Namibian people, therefore, that these measures that we have announced and the ones that we have adopted would be implemented with expediency and full commitment. And we want to assure them also that these measures were formally adopted by Cabinet today. Of course, usually decisions of a Cabinet meeting that we held today await ratification by the decision-making Cabinet meeting. But the President has given his stamp of approval to this clearance that was given to these measures. So these measures are formally adopted by the government, and we therefore assure our sisters, our mothers, and our daughters, and our sons as well, whom I applaud for coming out to express their disdain at what their own sisters, mothers, and the nieces are being subjected to, that we are with them. We are not in disagreement with them. We are not in conflict with them. We share in their anger. We are not the enemy. The enemy is sexual and gender-based violence. And we want to hold hands with them so that we can tackle this enemy of the Namibian people.